Good evening. Hello, hello, hello. How's everybody doing tonight? Emotions can't express really what's going on. We've had a crazy, awesome day, amen? Been able to celebrate all that our church has been up to and everything that's been going on, especially pertaining to Kentucky Missions now. So here we are, Kentucky Missions 2013, and it was Kentucky Missions, I think it was Kentucky Missions 2001, when I stood here this morning and I went up to Dr. Don and Seth and I said, because of Kentucky Missions, I feel that I am being called into full-time ministry. And because of that, my life has ever been changed, amen? And because of that, that's what we are here tonight to do, is to celebrate the things that God has done in 250 plus missionaries in the hills of Kentucky. We've seen students come to know Jesus. We've seen students rededicate their lives to Christ. We have seen students for the first time ever in their lives share the gospel with students who have received Jesus for the first time. We have seen students make commitments to full-time missions and to participate in missions here in Spartanburg, all in 1 week. How about that? Is that cool or what? Me and Seth were talking earlier today, and it's trying to figure out how best can we, in 1 hour or an hour and a half, describe what really goes on during a week of Kentucky. And he always tells me it's like this. It's like if we went out front, plugged our mouth up to the fire hydrant, and just opened it up full throttle. And that's a hard thing for us to be able to grasp, is when we go fire hydrant. But our job tonight is to kind of give you just a small glimpse of what's going on in the chapel services at night with our students, and then on the ground each and every day at basketball camps and at the VBSs in the evenings. But before we get started tonight, Dr. Don's gonna come up and he's gonna open us up in a word of prayer. So let's give it up for Dr. Don.
Hello, KY13. Sorry, hashtag KY13. I missed it. Hashtag KY13. It's great to see you today, and what an incredible ministry you've had this past week again. And I was just talking to Seth, and he arrived here in end of 96. And some of you may or may not know this, because our church had been involved in Kentucky for years. And like everybody and like everything in life, you got to breathe fresh air into yourself, into your life, your marriage, your family, your schoolwork. I'm sorry to bring that up. Your studies. You got to, every now and again, you've got to take a look at it and you've got to say, listen, man, I've been driving the same motor car down the same road, doing the same thing, and it's all great. But if I keep doing that, just driving down the same road in the same motor car, your tires are going to wear thin. And the best thing you can do is to put on a fresh set of tires and breathe some fresh air into your life. Some of you people who are married, you got to do that in your marriage, you know. You've got to. You've got to sit down. You've got to say, wait a minute. The day you sit down and say, we've been married for 15 years, and this is the way it's going to be, that's the day in which most likely you begin to get into a downhill slide. It happens like that at school, and it happens like that as Christians. You know, you can get into such a routine as a Christian that you actually stop acting like a Christian. You can get so accustomed to being a Christian living in the world that you eventually just begin to look like the world. You've actually got to breathe some fresh air into yourself. So in 96, I brought Seth here to the church. I think it was December of 96. And Kentucky was wonderful, incredible ministry, long before I came here. And I sat down with Seth. He's sitting right there. And he was brand new in the church. And I said to him, Seth, Kentucky Missions is a golden egg in this church. It's a jewel. It's a ministry that if you try to explain it to people, you can't explain it, right? Have you ever tried to explain Kentucky Missions to someone who's never been there? Well, you know, we all there and, you know, we go to these churches in these hollers and you know, all these people and we do VBSs and you try to explain something like that, it's not nearly as easy to explain it as it is to do it and to be a part of it. I said to Seth, Seth, you've got the right stuff. You're the right leader, and God speaks through you. I want you to go to Kentucky in the summer of 97. And when you come back, I want you to tell me whether you think this is something we need to keep doing or not. Because one thing we are not going to do in this church is we're not going to just do something because we're supposed to just do something. If it's not bringing glory to the Lord and making a difference, if it's not putting a vibe into our young people, if it's not changing lives, if it's not producing people like Matt Kuhn, if it's going to produce people like Matt Kuhn, you can count me in. And if it will produce, you got it. And if it's going to produce the kind of young people like you that we see coming out of Kentucky, yeah, you do a tremendous amount for all those people. I mean, I've looked at your pictures and been entering into what God has done. You can see the faces of those children, man, that you just grew to love, those that gave their lives to Christ. But I tell you, the biggest impact is sitting right here in this auditorium tonight. Because if your life has a breath of fresh air and you come back from Kentucky and a fire burns in your soul spirit, I'd take you anywhere with me. And you're the kind of young man, young lady that God's going to use. Because you're a life changer. And Seth came back in the summer of 97. I guess it must have been there. It used to be in July, I think, man. I remember those days. It was so hot we couldn't breathe. It was like near the end of July. Am I remembering correctly? And if you think it was hot this past week, at the end of July, it gets a little steamy up there. And we came back from Kentucky, and Seth sat down with the ministry team. And we knew that God was involved in this. And I want to just say, I am so proud of you guys, man. I am so proud of you. I'm so proud of everything that you've done. I'm so proud of those things that you did this week that nobody else saw. And guys, I'm just telling you, I know it happened. I'm so proud of the number of times you guys walked across that little parking lot and picked up that little child that had never been picked up like that before. I'm so proud of you sitting and singing your heart out when nobody else was singing. I'm so proud of the way you just went up and put your arm around against somebody who just wanted a little bit of love. I'm so proud of the fact that you did what you did. College students, the mountain mamas, every single one of you, single adults, chaperones, the people that made it happen. I'm so grateful to God for you. So yeah, I welcome you back today, but I thank God for what you've done. And I'm going to tell you something, guys. It could be as late as 20 to 30 to 40 years from now. You'll be somewhere. And you'll get a tap on your shoulder, and an adult will look in your face and say, "You don't recognize me, do you?" And you're going to say, "No, I've never seen you in my life." And they're going to say to you, well, I just want you to know, #KY13, I was this little girl. Who nobody really loved. I was this boy. And all I knew in my life were dirt roads, hollers, and four-letter words coming up one side my face. And you came to Kentucky. And you don't even remember it, but you sat with me outside one day. And you showed me how to give my heart to Jesus. And today, let me tell you about my life right now. Let's pray together. Lord, in this room today, there are the most incredible missionaries I've ever been around. And Father, when the noise dies down and the fun and the laughter and the pizzas and the late nights and the foot washings and the high fives, when it's all said and done, Lord, you've taken a group of people like this and you've used them to impact and change lives forever. They've lived out the Christian life. And Lord, I thank you for every one of these people. I thank you so much for the incredible group of leaders, for the adults that went, for the time, the energy. I thank you, Lord, for every superintendent, every teacher, everyone who sang every song, every gesture. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, for every touch of every finger that touched the life of somebody that needed to be touched for Jesus. #KY13. It's all yours, Lord Jesus. It's all yours. And now we're ready to rumble. It's time to celebrate as we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Some say we're kind of crazy.
We're going to have a time of praise and worship now as Hunter and Kristen are coming up to lead us in a couple of songs. One of the things that has always been a very special part of Kentucky Missions is the time that we share each night in chapel. And we wanted to do two songs right now that were really kind of special for us. One is Send Us to the Nations that was written by Jared Espy. And then I Can Only Imagine, a song that we have sung for so many years, and it's just a reminder of the hope that we try to present over the course of a week to children and young people and adults who trust in Christ. And so Hunter, one of our recent high school graduates, is going to lead us in Christian. Thank you.
What it would be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence? And to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. 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 I can only imagine what all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine what all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Thank you.
us to the nations, to the broken. Lead us to surrender, we will go. Send us to the nations, to the broken. Lead us to surrender, we will go.
The hungry.
With all your heart.
Eternally.
And we will run.
We
surrender, we will go. Send us to the nations, to the broken. Lead us to surrender, we will go. And if our God is for us, how can we fail? May the power of Jesus we stand. And if our God is for us, how can we fail? May the power of Jesus we stand.
One more time.
Send us to the nations, to the broken. Lead us to surrender, we will go. Send us to the nations, to the broken. Lead us to surrender, we will go.
Amen. Normally during this time, we take up an offering. And so we just want to take a moment to thank God for all that he's done through those tithes and offerings this year and for those that we will receive for Kentucky next year. Because I know there are many students whose lives were impacted in Kentucky who are still there through your gifts and offerings and tithes. And there are many here in this room who were given scholarships who would not have been able to go otherwise, whose lives were changed forever. So we just want to thank God for the faithfulness of his people and the faithfulness of him as well. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful Sunday that you've blessed us with, for our church and the celebration of what has been going on here, how you've used our pastor for the past 20 years. But we also want to pause now, Father, and just thank you for the faithfulness of your people and how their tithes and offerings have been used to make your name known throughout this nation, throughout this city, this state, and other states, and even the world, Father, as we just look back on the past 6 months and think of all the mission trips that we have had, all the folks who have traveled and gone, and even coming up here in the next week and a half or so of another group going to Brazil. We just thank you for these opportunities, Father. But we just thank you for your people and their faithfulness. We ask that you would continue to bless our church, the tithes and offerings that your people so faithfully offer each and every week. We love you, Lord, and we ask all these things in the strong, mighty, and powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Some days life feels perfect. Other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. So it's crazy, amazing. We can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak. Other days my thoughts just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well, it's crazy to imagine words from my lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak.
like rain when you speak life with the words you say. Raise your thoughts a little higher. Use your words to inspire. Trouble fall like rain when you speak life with the things you say. Lift your head a little higher. Spread the love like fire. Hope will fall like rain when you speak life with the words you say. So speak life. Someone
and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
That was almost one of those fire hydrant moments, just trying to give you a taste as much as we can. And even that obviously does not tell the story. Reaching over 2,000 children and youth and adults this week at 27 different ministry points. It's just an amazing to see what God did this week. And one of the things that we've discovered through the past number of years is hearing a brief snippet from some of the folks that went usually is the best way for you to kind of catch a glimpse. And I'm going to ask those folks if they'll come up here right now, Randy and Danny and Tommy and Polly, if they'll make their way up here. I'm going to ask Randy to go first. And those of you who've been here for a number of years know that Randy Welchel he's the lay leader for Kentucky Missions. And we actually will be meeting tomorrow, and then beginning in September, we begin to meet just about weekly in preparation for Kentucky Missions. And I can't express enough my thanks and appreciation for all the work that Randy does throughout the year in leading Kentucky Missions. And so I'm going to ask Randy, if he would, to share a few words, and then we're going to have Danny and Tommy and Polly share their perspective of Kentucky. Randy?
Well, I have to say one thing. Today, my cup runneth over. Coming back from Kentucky after a week with these young people, the joy I had in my heart, and then coming, the service we had today is unbelievable. Seth asked me to talk a little bit about some of the years that I'd gone to Kentucky, and I got to thinking about some names. People like Bob Caldwell, who was my first superintendent. Rob Wilton, who was a superintendent in my group, Shelley Wilton, Daniel Black, Matt Lanford, Keely McCaslin, David Dennis, Andrew Sebesky. These are just people I saw today at church that kind of got my mind to thinking about, wow, look where God is, how he's been using all of these different young people in so many different ways. This year I had the privilege of having unbelievable team led by four seniors. And I remember the last night when I was taking all the kids home, got back to Mount Mary, which is on top of the mountain, and I pulled into the parking lot and I saw my four seniors that had been with me since the ninth grade sitting on the side of the mountain just reflecting about the last 4 years as tears flowed down their face. A very emotional moment. And I shared with them later watching them, it was unbelievable how they loved these kids. Didn't matter if they were rich or poor, clean or dirty. Didn't matter what they had done in their life. They loved these kids. They loved every one of them. And I challenged them as we got ready. We finished on Friday. We met and we had just a short challenge. And I told them, you know, how different would our church look if we loved every single person in our church the way you love these kids in Kentucky? No matter what they've done, no matter if they've said something that really hurt you, don't matter. You love them. The Bible I read says when the Holy Spirit comes to live in you, we're new people, we're new creatures, and that love should flow out of us. And sometimes I see people who are willing to go out and witness to a stranger, but they'll turn their back on their best friend because of something they've done maybe a year ago, 2 years ago, whenever, I don't know. But I challenge each one of you. I told my Sunday school class today, think about how you feel right now. You didn't go out and buy a new iPod or iPad or whatever it may be to get that great feeling, which after a while, you know, it becomes old and now it's no excitement anymore. But what you did something that changed your life forever. That's what God wants us to do. And that's why I have a lot of people say, "What? Do you not ever get tired of going to Kentucky?" Well, so far, I haven't gotten tired of watching kids come to know the Lord, watching people accept Christ, watching our kids love on people regardless. And I'm planning on going as long as the Lord allows me to go.
This is my first year going to Kentucky. Several years ago when we started attending this church, a great friend and mentor of mine, Coach John Craig, called me out front one night and said, "Hey, you ever been to Kentucky?" I said, "No, I hadn't." In a way, hell, he can say it, he says, "Y'all think about it. Y'all think about it." And I said, "Well, what goes on up here?" He says, "Well, you just got to go. You just got to go." And I said, "Well, Coach, what is it, man? Tell me, what's so special about Kentucky?" He says, just go. Well, Seth had, since that time, asked me to consider going and being a parent for the week and a Kentucky parent. And my wife had told me, she said, last year, we travel a lot during the summer with sports, and both of my kids are athletic, and I'm around young people a lot. And she told me last summer, she said, "Look," she said, "we're going to Kentucky. We're going. Our kids are going to Kentucky before they graduate." And I said, "Well," in a very weak moment, I said, "Well, why don't we just all go?" And that weak moment was a divine moment in my life. It was appointed by God, no doubt about it. I'll never look at a white van the same again, 15-passenger van. For those of you who hadn't been, the joy on those kids' faces when they see that white van come around the bend, up to those hollers, pull up in front of their house, and for just that 4 or 5 days of that week, get to run out and jump on there and be loved on and ministered to, and just to know that somebody cares. Some of the places we go, quite honestly, in Spartanburg County would be condemned. And there's kids living there, not just one or two kids. We go to one house to pick up for our church, and it's a 3-bedroom house. There must be 15 kids get out and get on our van. We make one trip for one house on a 15-passenger van, and they're all staying there. And they've all got a story, different story. The parents have passed away from overuse of drugs, or just given up on them, or just ran off, and they all live there together. And those kids just rip your heart out. These kids blow your mind. So I'm telling you something, guys. This group is uncommon. As I said, I'm around young people all the time. And sometimes we look for things to pick with, things to pick at, and things to see with kids, young people especially. Well, man, I can't believe they would do this. I can't believe it. Well, I'm telling you, I can't believe they would do this. These kids are difference makers. You know, I met some of these kids when they were just little kids down at the First Baptist baseball softball fields at Heading Home. And I coached them there and, you know, and watch them play and watch them grow. And you see them at church and you see them at the hangar and you see them at Crossfire. And you just wonder, where they stand? Are they getting it? I mean, I know your parents put a lot of time and effort into and making sure they're at programs, making sure they're doing things. Well, I'm telling you, parents, they get it. They got it. When you see these kids loving on these little kids that have nothing and with a purpose of just sharing Jesus. That was the purpose of going. It wasn't to play games or to hang out or to have water balloon fights, the stuff I liked to do when I was their age. It was to share the love of Jesus with them. And wow, what a job they did. If anybody out there is sitting on the fence and wondering, hey, I don't know if I can take that Kentucky trip or not. I don't know if it's for me or not. Man, I don't know if I can take the late nights. I don't know if I can handle all that. You know, dirty kids, I don't know if I can be around it. I don't know. I just don't know if that's for me. If God's tapping you on the shoulder, it's for you. It's for me. I fought it. I didn't think we'd go. I really didn't. But praise God, I went. Praise God, I went. Because I got to see, first off, change lives in Kentucky. And these guys right here changed my life in Kentucky. And I thank you.
Thank you, man. I love you, man.
First thing I'd like to say is we all need to give a very big round of applause to our group parents. We've been so privileged to have adults that give up an entire week and then some just to come out and love on us and love on these kids. So if everybody would stand and please clap for your group parents, they definitely deserve it. My group dad in particular had a certain struggle, and it went by the name of Wesley. This kid was absolutely crazy. He was all over the walls, jumping up and down, biting, kicking, scratching, screaming, everything you can imagine. By the end of the first day, dad over here just had him in a good old bear hug and kept him there for really the last hour of the night. But just as the day went along, and as the week went along at VBS, it was really incredible to watch how Wesley changed. Every day he got a little quieter, he got a little more respectful, and he paid attention more. And by the end of the week, he was completely checked in. Like, he was all the way there, and he was focused on the real reason that we were there. And I really don't have anybody to thank for that except Dad. He was really incredible with that. For me, I have so many stories I could tell. I could be up here for hours. But the name Seth. Seth was a little 3 or 4 year old at Middlesboro High School for our basketball camp. And this kid was off the walls too. Absolutely crazy, so much energy, always talking, always running around doing stuff while we were trying to pray. He was insane. But he would always call out for me, which I thought was really cool because I had never really had that. I knew like the kids liked me and stuff, but I never had one that really focused on me. And that was really cool. And every day he would get up, he would show up to camp, and he would say he was hungry. Well, by the second or third day, I would tell him it was time to go to lunch, and all he wanted to do was sit there on the bleachers and talk. He didn't care about going to eat. He just wanted to sit there and be with me. And that was really cool. It was something I hadn't really felt before. And then he started doing this thing where I would ask him not to do something, and then he would do it anyway. And then he would look back up at me, and with these huge puppy dog eyes that you can't really say no to, he would just say, "But you still love me, right? Like, you still care about me, you still love me." And I mean, of course, my heart melted and I said yes every single time because this kid was adorable. But it just really, it touched me how, yeah, the kids are hungry and they want food and they want to be with friends and learn more about God. But above all of that, they just want attention and they want like real, genuine love. They don't want the love that their parents show them by leaving them home alone for 3 days or by not feeding them for a week. It's really just sad, but such a little thing to us, the word love, which we toss around everywhere. We love going to eat. We love going to see movies, whatever. That word gets tossed around for us, but it really has a deeper meaning for them. And to be able to go and just show love to these kids is really an incredible blessing. And I'm so grateful for my group specifically, just for blessing me and being witnesses when you were tired and hot. And I just thank you for showing love to everyone that we met.
Well, this is my first year going, and like I was blessed, so blessed for. Oh my gosh, my sounds weird. Okay. So the first few days, I had first and third graders, and I noticed that the little girl's shoes was broken, like all of them, literally, or they were really old, and it just got me thinking, like I should do something about it. So I talked to Ryan, who's in my class. So, yay. And we both talked about it, and we went to Walmart and picked out some shoes. And just like God gives us a new heart and takes our broken heart away, I just thought of like giving them new shoes and taking their old heart. It's kind of like, you know, that's how I saw it. So I gave them the shoes, and like it was just incredible because I was trying to bless them, but I was blessed because kind of like Christmas all over again for them. And their faces were just like so priceless and so sweet. And like when they asked me to sign their shoes, I was like, oh my gosh, it's so cool. But I was really happy, and that really like changed everything, like how I saw everything. And that like one of those shoes can really like mean a lot to them. So I thought that was really cool. So, yeah.
Thank y'all. One of the statements that I make in Kentucky, or about Kentucky missions, is in Kentucky you become what you've always wanted to be. You like that. What happens there, that transformation that takes place in your life, is what you discover when you give your life away. When you serve others, you begin to discover why God made us. He made us to honor Him and to serve Him and to give our lives away to others. And so I think you saw an indication of that through those testimonies. Another way to maybe capture a glimpse of that is through video. And I'll tell you, I really appreciate the media team here at First Baptist. One of the things that I pray for is for our students that graduate and go off to college and move off to other areas, and they look for a church home. They just assume that there's video crews everywhere, I guess, in every church in America, and it's just not the case. And we are very blessed here with the media team that God has called to First Baptist Spartanburg and their support of so many ministries. We saw that evident this morning in the worship service and all that they did for today. And then you're going to see part of that now as we watch this video on Kentucky.
Kentucky has impacted my life because as I've grown in Christ, I've realized ways to talk to kids, and I've seen how when you break down the barriers a kid has, you can see the stories behind their scars and the pain behind their tears, and you're just able to show how much God loves them through your actions and the way you speak to them and the way you hold them and the way you look at them, and you're just really able to connect with them, and you're able to convey how much God loves them and that, you know, they're not alone in this world, that we all came here to love them and to be with them. If you're scared that you don't matter, if you're lost and need to be found, if you're looking for a savior, all you gotta do is turn around. Hey.
This year, this is my last year coming out. Probably I may come back in college, but I just want to give it all out to God. I've made mistakes, and everybody up here makes mistakes too. And I can relate to them, and they can understand me plenty. And I just want to show them that God does give grace, even if we've made bad mistakes. And Kentucky is not only a mission trip, but it's saving you too. It's a mission trip for yourself. It builds character. It shows you where to go. You're crazy if you're not on fire for Christ by Friday or Saturday.
Well, I keep coming back to Kentucky because you come to Kentucky hoping to change the life of a kid, but at the same time, they change your life and they change your heart. And you go into situations that are so heartbreaking, and the clothes that you see people wear and the homes that you see people live in just breaks your heart, and you just take for granted what you have, and I think you realize that when you're at Kentucky, how much you have and how fortunate you are. And so that's why I keep coming back to Kentucky.
You can impact someone's life. That you may not think that I'm not that important. If you come, you'll be a hero to some of these kids. You can become one of their best friends. Then you can impact so many more, because then that kid go back to some of their friends and say, "Hey, I met one of my best friends of all time at VBS. You should come and meet him." And that's another way that they can come, and we get more kids coming where they can learn about God and hopefully eventually be saved. If it's not with us, then we're planting that seed where further down the road they may be able to come and know Him.
First, I was kind of hesitant about coming on this trip, and I was kind of scared to come on this trip, actually, because I was praying and stuff. But once you get here, you realize that it's not really about what you want to do, it's about what you're doing for God, and that's just been amazing. And I just, I'm so glad I came.
I think that teenagers should come to Kentucky because it's a good way to put yourself out there and a good place to learn how to share Jesus with others so that you can go home and share it with others there, and just a good basis for that. And also, as much as you bless the children, they bless you so much. They show you what it's like to love unconditionally.
When we sing at chapel, it doesn't feel like anybody else is in the room except me. It's just me and the Lord, and I think it's a great time just for me to talk to Him just about who I need to be thinking about during the week, a specific child that I need to be praying for, or just praising Him for what He's already done or for what He's going to do. And that's one thing that I love. It's a good time just to reconnect with Him and just thank Him for everything that He's done.
Kind of hard to follow. So much to say. I'll never forget last Saturday night, as we prayed over the students who are going to be preaching in the pulpit on Sunday morning. It's pretty huge to have them all lined up, and then we had family and friends and other folks lay hands on them and pray over them, and then there were a lot of tweets that were going out, prayer requests, and then I got a tweet message from Greg Wilton, who said, 10 years ago this year, I preached my first sermon in Kentucky, and that's where God called me to the ministry. And I just thought about the number of students that have been placed in a position during Kentucky that puts them out of their comfort zone, and they realize God's call on their life to some degree. It may not necessarily be full-time ministry, but it could be that I've got to be involved in the work of the Lord no matter what I do. You know, if I'm a businessman, if I'm a teacher, whatever it is I do, I've also got to be involved in doing the work of the Lord. And so it's amazing to see how that continues to work through the years. And over 40 years, like 44 years now, we have been going to Kentucky. And thanks to the vision of Dr. Alistair Walker and the ministries that have taken place since then, we go back each year. And we don't go back out of tradition. We go back out of calling. And it's fresh every year. This is my 17th year, and I can honestly tell you that it was just as fresh for me this year as it was the very first year I went. There were new experiences, new faces, and new opportunities. And so there's so many things that I want to share. I will say this, that there were a number of students this week that led someone to Christ for the very first time. They never did that before. And if those students are here tonight, would you stand up? If this week you presented the gospel, somebody prayed to receive Christ this week for the very first time, stand up. If you led a child to Christ. All right, remain standing. Now I want you to see this. Remain standing. Remain standing. Okay, for everybody else who's here, if it was in Kentucky that you led your first child to Christ, I want you to stand up. Not just this year, but in the last. Okay. Be seated. You can be seated. I just wanted you to see, I mean, why do we go to Kentucky? Well, one of the things is it's a laboratory experience where it's a controlled environment. And students are sold out. They're talking about Jesus. They're singing about Jesus. They're teaching about Jesus. And it's in that environment that they, for many of them, you just saw it, that's where they led someone to Christ for the very first time. And our prayer is that when they come back, that continues. You know, we don't want it to be 1 week out of the year, be 1 week wonders. We want it to be 52 weeks out of the year. I do need to say just a few words of thanks. And I always get nervous about this time because I'm sure there's somebody that I'll miss, but I want to roll through this. I appreciate, first of all, beginning along with Randy, there's somebody else that meets really in the fall as well. They begin planning and preparing, and that is our Mountain Mamas under the leadership of Linda Gildon. And Linda, I know, is back here in the back, and she's had quite a journey the last couple of weeks. And Linda was not able to go with us this year for the first time in a long time. Linda was not able to go to Kentucky with us because she suffered a major burn on her foot just a couple of weeks prior to Kentucky. But because of her prior planning, because prior planning prevents poor performance, and because of those five P's that Linda and the Mountain Mamas implement, this week went off without a hitch. And so I want to thank especially our Mountain Mamas, Linda Gildon, for y'all's leadership this week and all that you did. I'm gonna roll through some of these names and just kind of applaud in your heart as I go through so that we don't take too much time tonight. But I just think it's significant for me to share some of these thoughts that I have. The year-round emphasis on missions that Steve Wise and our Impact Office gives to us is incredible. The direction that they give our church, I really believe in my heart that years ago when Steve began to lead that ministry, there was a shift in our church. And I've really begun to see that happen in so many different ways, where it's a year-round emphasis on missions and not just trips. And we're reaching folks here locally and in Kentucky and around the world. And so I've already mentioned our media team, our 18-wheeler driver, Joel Cox, who is also our loan construction team member this year. We need to up those numbers for next year. But Greg and Angela Springsteen, they're patience in helping these students get engaged in VBS and the whole children's ministry team, their leadership, because that week prior to Kentucky is a very important part of preparation. And I appreciate their help in that. Eddie Robertson, and the reason I say this, y'all, so many, I interview every student that goes to Kentucky in my office, And it's only about a 10 or 15 minute interview, but it's I want to read their testimony. I want to hear their heart as to why they want to go to Kentucky. And over half of the students that go to Kentucky at Camp Voyager, that is when Jesus Christ became real. And so I want you to see a partnership here. There's a partnership here in our church. This is not a, you know, if you come up and go, oh, Seth, this, we so appreciate you so much. Kentucky Missions, just saying. Well, here's the deal. It's the entire church. It's everybody playing their role. So if you do come up tonight, I want you to say, well, it's the church. It's the body of Christ. It's not one person. It's not one ministry. It's all of us working together. It's every person doing their part. And we're blessed here at our church to have so many different people in those areas that give more than competent leadership and ministry. I appreciate Upward, Kaz, the generosity of Upward Ministries there has just been incredible. We fully clothe 5 basketball camps, children with jerseys, and we give them basketballs. I'm just telling you, when you see kids come and they've got one shirt they wear every day, and then we give them that Upward shirt, it is unbelievable. It is like gold. And we give them that bag. It's just hard to express. And so I appreciate them and the cheerleading ministry that started last year that Aubrey helped to kind of direct this year in our different sites. That has kind of taken off to a new level. You know, folks that support us, Mr. Keith Laws, our ride back down the mountain is a fun ride when we arrive at the Welcome Center rest area just south of Asheville, when we invade a rest area where normally there's a couple of folks out there having a leisurely lunch afternoon, and then 250 folks kind of arrive at the same time. And Keith Laws has hundreds of Chick-fil-A sandwiches there ready for us, he and his team there and his family. And this year we got to meet Si, who was there. Actually, it wasn't Si, but it sure looked like him. And our kids were all taking pictures with him. It was pretty funny. That guy was loving life, too. Janet Adams and the meals that she prepared for all of the families that came back, the adults who went, were able to drive into the parking lot yesterday and have meals provided for them, and that was an incredible blessing. The supply chain every day, we had folks coming up and coming back, bringing folks back, bringing folks up, and bringing stuff up. It was just, it takes everybody playing their part. The food distribution team, you know, when you work to try to feed close to 2,000 children, which, by the way, the state of Kentucky funds all of that. And by the way, they had budget cutbacks this year. And so the children will not be fed during the month of July. I heard that on the last day. Believe it or not, there are children that may eat twice a week. The type of nutrition that they have is whatever's available. And it's not uncommon for a child, once we drop them off at the end of VBS on that Friday, that they will not leave their holler until the bus picks them up in mid-August. So for 6 weeks, that's their life in that holler. And so for 1 week, it is like Christmas. And it's a lot easier to tell a child about Jesus when their tummy's full and they've got a new shirt on their back and they're looking into your eyes and they know you love them, and they want to know what changed you and what made you come up here to tell me about this Jesus. And I'm convinced that it's all part of that big picture. But Jay Nichols and the food ministry team that we have, I know they're here. I want them to stand up just for a minute. They were all over the hills of Kentucky. Jay, are you here? Food team, if y'all would stand. I can't thank them enough. That ministry started, thanks guys, that ministry started years ago when Neely Arrington, I'll never forget it, Neely Arrington was, she saw a little girl eating some flowers. And she said, oh baby, you can't eat the flowers. And she looked at him and she said, but I'm so hungry. And she said, what'd you eat for breakfast? And she discovered that she had not eaten in 3 days. And so David and Cheryl Hill were the group moms, mom and dad at the time, and man, they went to the store and they loaded up and filled the pantry up at that house. And the next year, the food team started. So, and it's been a blessing ever since. Goes on the newspaper team, Jeff Lancaster, Christopher Huey, and Matt Kuhn. I can't thank those guys enough for the wee hours of the night, the laughs we've had, and trying to keep our students connected with what was happening in different groups as best we could. I guess my favorite picture, though, that we printed this week was the one where Steve Wise got nailed in the nose with a Frisbee. It wasn't intentional, but right over his right shoulder, the picture we put in the newspaper, by the way, it was our newspaper. It wasn't like USA Today or anything, okay? Just didn't want you to Google it. But Luke Renfro, who threw the Frisbee, was right over the shoulder of Steve Wise with a little smile on his face. So, I appreciate Jim Miller and the logistics. If you're up there on Saturday when we arrive, the only thing you hear is the name Grandma over and over and over again, answering questions. And I know that we weren't going to do a whole lot of clapping, but I just want to express our word of thanks to Jim Miller. I can't express what he does for Kentucky Missions. He's in the video booth. Nurse Kathy, I'm telling you, the list goes on. Nurse Kathy, I can't say thank you enough. And it was all through the night sometimes that she was having to take care of some folks. Our student ministry staff, Matt, Christopher, Kristen, Coach Craig, and Rhonda Lanford. I would put our team up with anybody as far as efficiency, passion, love for what we do, and we love being together. We love serving, and it is quite a privilege. I will say that there was a group of folks that were put into positions of leadership this week that was a little bit of a challenge because they'd never done this before, but our superintendents, our high school seniors that stepped up. And I tell you, we had an incredible senior class. We had, I think it was 35 seniors that went this year. Largest group of seniors we've ever taken to Kentucky. And we had 14 of those that served as superintendents. But I think the superintendents will tell you that there's a number, all those other seniors could have stepped in some way and did and lead to some degree. But I want the 14 superintendents, if they would stand up, just so we can express our thanks to you and your leadership this week. We've already expressed our thanks to the moms and dads who were. Many of them were kind of roped in situations where they thought they knew what they were getting into, but they had no idea that they had to discover how to run a triage unit and clean snotty noses and drive vans and realize that GPS is not effective. All these different kinds of things. Cell phone service is spotty at best, but I appreciate their role in ministry this week. But the one, I guess, of all these that I've expressed thanks for, our pastor's vision for student ministry is one of the things that has fueled the fire for where we are today. And I appreciate Dr. Wilton, his love for students, his desire to see our student ministry continue to reach the lost, and his support. And he goes above and beyond than most pastors that I've ever met. Dr. Wilton, I don't want to say the phrase, he puts his money where his mouth is, but I'll say this, that when the student ministry needs something, he really goes that extra mile to make sure that whatever we need to do to reach the lost and to do these kinds of trips, he makes it happen. And that's across the board with our children. He believes in this generation, and I can't thank him enough. Over $130,000 was invested in a week's time in Southeast Kentucky. Who can forget Ingles, spelled with an E? Milkshakes from Ingles. Hillbillies, only a few got to experience that this year. Dairy Queen, Wendy's, The Oasis, La Esperanza, Subway, the Walmart runs, Sonny's Barbecue Friday night. Amen. Kentucky Mountain Trio. Yes. There were so many things this week that we will treasure. The money was invested, and you know, the that helped make this week happen. But there were so many other different avenues of ministry that took place that maybe you weren't aware of, even our kids were aware of. But the folks that supported even before we got there. And I think about the people who pray throughout the year. There are folks actually sitting here right now that you don't have a student that went on the trip. You don't have a grandchild that went on the trip. But you have been praying for student ministry. Maybe you went to Kentucky 25 years ago, and you come tonight just to celebrate and to praise the Lord for what he's done. What I would ask you to do is pray with us, as because when we left on Saturday and rolled out, there were people literally on the highway waving at us. I will never forget driving through Pineville, and there was two young boys, I think, and there was maybe it was the mom that was there with them, and I think they went to Bethel with Phil's group. I believe that's right. And the young man received Christ, or one of the children had received Christ that week. At least that's what was said over the airwaves. And they were standing there waving at the row of white vans rolling through. So what we leave behind up there is not just a cash investment, although there was a lot that was invested. But there are basketballs that will be driving parents crazy in the trailers and shacks and hollers. There will be frisbees with the gospel message that were kindly donated to us. And I'm telling you, they were flying everywhere. That was one that nailed Steve, by the way. There were shirts, shoes, food. There's so much that I could go on to say that was donated throughout the year. But there's still ways for you to be involved. We need adults at night to help with the large groups. We had several churches, we had over 150. And we need adults there just to love on kids. Medical teams, just to come up for 2 days. Help in the basketball camps. The prison ministry continues to flourish. And we, Steve and I talked about this. We'd love to have one person who says, I will take that on as a ministry that I'll be involved in every year and come up, and that'll be my ministry. And you can come up and help lead that. We have the opportunity to go into the Bell County Forestry Camp, which is an incredible opportunity to share the gospel in a prison setting. So many other things that you can be involved in. The eyes of a hero, you may ask, what in the world does that mean? Through the eyes of a hero, it's worth it all. To be a hero, there has to be something at stake. There has to be something at stake. There has to be a risk involved. And there has to be a decision to make. Otherwise, anybody can do it. If there's no risk involved, then anybody can do it. It really wouldn't be heroic. But in making that decision, after you follow through with that decision, when a hero looks at the accomplishment or what took place, you hear that phrase, oh, that was worth it all. I think of when Jesus looks at us, the redeemed, and says it's worth it all, that should be motivation for us to go to any length possible. And in many ways, these children looked at us as their heroes. And so using that concept for a week of our life, they looked at us as heroes through our eyes. What we did this week, it was worth it all. But really, a true hero doesn't even think about the risk. They see what's at stake, and the decision is to go. And so God has called us to go and to share. And I can't thank you enough for supporting Kentucky missions the way that you do, supporting our students the way that you do. And I could share so many stories. You can see these videos and things online later if you want to share them with friends. There's so much more that I could say. My heart is so full. I know the night is long. I'm going to ask Steve Wise if he would begin to make his way up here. He wanted to share something. And then we're going to sing two songs, and then I've asked Phil Vanderplug if he could close out our prayer, our night tonight. And if Steve comes up, he's going to share about our commitment time on Wednesday night. And then for Phil closing us in prayer, it's symbolic of the passing of the torch, passing of the baton, if you will, to our seniors as they now transition under Phil's leadership and ministry. Tonight at Merge, there will be several of the college students that are going to be sharing their testimonies. And that's going to be taking place right when we dismiss from here. And would love for you to go and continue to hear in this afterglow of what God has done in our college ministry. And I appreciate Phil's support of what we're doing so much through the college ministries here. But Steve, thank you for all that you mean to us here at First Baptist. And share with us about that Wednesday night service.
Well, before I do that, I think we all ought to give a big round to the Lord for giving us Seth Buckley as the student minister here, shouldn't we? Well, Wednesday night has come to be the mission commitment night in Kentucky. And, you know, as the missions minister, Kentucky's one of the easiest mission trips I ever get to make because I really don't have to do anything in preparation for it. And during the week, I ride around in a big old truck with Seth and Jamie and watch the students do their jobs. And it's just, it's great. It's one of the most wonderful things. I feel so blessed to be called to be the minister of missions here and to be a part of this. But my biggest job has to do with what they're going to do with what God does to them later. And so, you know, we want to challenge them. And on Wednesday night, we push them. We have a commitment card that we give them all. And it contains a lot of commitments that we challenge them to make. And our biggest point is that Kentucky is 1 week, and we are all called to be disciple makers all the time. And so most of that time is in Spartanburg. And so I asked them all to consider what they should be doing here in Spartanburg and what they can be doing to make disciples of all the nations right here. And I also then tell them that I know that God is calling out many of them to actually be the ones that do go overseas and around our country to share Christ. And it's getting to be very challenging to us in our impact ministry about how we're going to facilitate getting them to the mission field. Because here are the tallies from Wednesday night. 176 people committed to pray for missions and the lost of the world. 30 students said that they would give a semester of their life on the mission field before they graduate college. Another 30 wanted more information about the journeyman program. That's a 2-year on the mission field, by the way. 42 students and adults said they believe God is calling them to missions. 76 promised to participate in a local mission project, and 38 have said that they will, actually 39, because another one told me this morning, 39 said they will help us with an apartment ministry, and we're going to be in 3 apartment complexes here in Spartanburg. Hopefully, sometime by spring, we'll be in there every week with Bible studies that our students primarily will be leading. So these are the cards that they turned in, and we prayed for them before they made the commitment, But with these cards in my hand, I'd like for you to join me in praying for these students that they'll follow through with those commitments. So let's pray together. Father, we love you and we thank you, Lord, for saving us. We thank you for being our friend. And Lord, we thank you that in your great plan, you use just ordinary people like us in your great mission, the greatest mission ever, the largest task ever, the task of testifying to every nation so that one day voices from every tribe and tongue will be praising your name. Lord, I thank you for these students that you are speaking to them and they are listening. I thank you for all of those who went to Kentucky, Lord, and who gave a hard week of service to you to see little children come to know Christ as Savior, to see lives changed among teenagers and among prisoners and among the parents of those children. Lord, I thank you. And I thank you for those that have decided, Lord, that their lives will be forever changed and they're going to make a commitment to you to pray every day for the lost of the world, to give a semester of their lives to missions before they graduate college, to spend 2 years on the mission field. Lord, and especially for those that have decided that they're going to follow you wherever you take them. Maybe it'll be Malaysia, or maybe it'll be China. We don't know where it may be. But they've said they'll be obedient. Lord, I thank you for this great church and for the many people that we've been able to support and take to the mission field. But this is a great challenge, and I pray we'll take it up. I pray that we'll be faithful. I pray we'll help these students to develop and to prepare for their call. And then we'll stand behind them in prayer and through our gifts so that they can go and they can share Christ with the nations. Lord, and I pray that you'd call out even more until we are overwhelmed, until we see no possible way to meet that need, and then we just watch you do it for us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for this celebration tonight. Lord, may the day come when every member of this church is actively engaged in your mission. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I've been doing some audibling up here at the line of scrimmage, unbeknownst to you, but those who see the order tonight, I've been making some changes trying to help us on time. And I'm going to ask Max's group if they'll go ahead and begin to get ready. We were going to do the music now, but I'm going to ask them to prepare to do their skit now. And go ahead and come on up and get ready. And then following that, Phil, if you'll come on up and be ready here to the side and after the skit. I'm just going to tell y'all the playbook right now, so you're getting that this is your order of worship. After the skit, then we're going to do two songs, and then Phil will close us. But you're going to want to see this. This was one of the skits that was used in sharing the message of the gospel, and I think it's going to be a blessing to you. So give us just about 60 seconds to get the stage set.
Falls like a curtain. All the things I once called certain, and I have to say the words I fear the most, I just don't know. And the questions without answers come and paralyze the dancer. So I stand here on the stage, afraid to move, afraid to fall. Oh, but fall I must on this truth that my life has been formed from the dust.
And I'm filled with awe and wonder, till the only burning question that remains is, who am I? Can I form a single mountain, take the stars in hand and count them? Can I even take a breath without God giving it to me? First and last, before all that has been, beyond all that will pass. God is God and I am not. I can only see a part of the picture he's painting. God is God and I am man. So I'll never understand it all.
Sometimes those skits communicated better than we could put into words. And I appreciate the Tuggersville group putting that together for us tonight. As we sing these last two songs, these were two that really became special. There's a whole bunch more that we sang every night. For those of you who listen by chapel on the or watched on the web, and then those who listen by the radio, I think Britt said one night we had anywhere from 340 to 350 that were watching on the web. And some from all the way out in the great Northwest were watching and connecting to what was happening late in the wee hours of the night and or the morning. So I appreciate that connection. But now it doesn't do it justice to try to bring all of it home and do it in two songs. But I think you're going to hear the passion in the students' hearts and voices as we sing these songs.
I stand to praise you, but I fall on my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak. Light the fire.
Light the fire.
In my soul.
Something about the name Jesus. There's something about the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Something about the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. Oh, how I love the name Jesus. It is the sweetest name I know.
Lord Jesus, Father, we thank you for who you are. And we know and acknowledge in this moment that you are Lord of all things. You are Lord of Kentucky. You are Lord of this church. You are Lord of every person in here. Father, I pray that you would do a mighty work in the hearts and lives of every person here tonight. Father, I thank you for how you have revealed yourself to us this week. I thank you, Father, for how you have allowed us to see your love through the love that we've seen in each other, toward each other, and towards the children that we ministered to. Father, I pray that you would do a sustaining work in our hearts, God, so we wouldn't just be people on mission for a week, but people on mission every minute of every day for all of our lives. God, I pray that we would not just have the boldness to drive in a van into a holler and to pick up children from homes where there are drugs and addictions and abuse. Father, but that we would also realize that children just like that are three blocks from this church. And Lord, that even more importantly than having the physical capacity to defend ourselves from hurting people, that you'd give us a heart to reach out to hurting people no matter what it costs us. That we would go into those neighborhoods and find those children who are being abused, because they are our responsibility. Father, what good is our steeple that rises to the sky in this city if children are being abused and are hungry a few blocks away? Father, I pray that you would anoint us with your Holy Spirit and with power, because with your power, whom shall we fear? And I pray, Father, we wouldn't be discouraged because of what we haven't done, but that we would be set on fire for what we can do. Father, I pray that you would use us, that you would use these teenagers, Father, to bring a revival to this city and to feed every hungry mouth and to look after every hurting child and to assist every hurting parent, that the world would see a mighty work here. Bless these students, Father. Deepen their conviction and their commitment to you, that they would put everything on the line to serve you and your kingdom. And I pray that they would fear nothing. In Jesus' name, amen.
As you leave tonight, I do want to make available to you, we do have some shirts, the hero shirts and some of the purple polos, which, by the way, we ordered in Christopher Huey's honor this year. And so those are available right outside this door. And I failed to mention our intern staff team. The interns have been absolutely phenomenal for us this year. And so we are blessed in this church, and I pray that you would go now and be a blessing to our community, and let's shine the light of Jesus and make a difference for him.
My mother saw you the day you set her free. Now raised up in a family where you were everywhere. And every single day we are walking proof that every living thing is an echo of you. Yeah, you are everywhere. You are everywhere. And I can see you.
Yeah. Time, you're everywhere beyond the limits of time. Created a time, baby, give it the help of special, but understand what it means to wait under the vine. No limitations to your nature is major. Knowing you are patiently dear through the good and the failures. I can never be without the one who is greater, newly created in Christ, bonded to the creator. Your will is my sanctification. Circumstances I'm facing, your grace is amazing. You turn up around from pain into praise, encountering attacks in the ways I can praise you. The sovereignty is astonishing. How the cosmic king dwells inside of me. Past iniquity, he's relinquished me from the tyranny of chaos to a symphony.
You surround me, Lord, with your graceful care. So open my eyes to your sovereign plans. I surrender my life into your hands.
Give me the eyes to see my life in light of eternity, so I can know you in your pain. I know for me you felt the same.
Moments when I'm all crawled up in the days when I'm feeling really drained. Running in a loopy maze of a life and begin to feel jaded. I'm hidden in my bunker while the world goes on. While singing a sombre song, it's the beginning of my demise. All of my hope is gone, like if I just upon my life feeling like a neglected tool. When I dine with the swine, is God there too? If I get the short end of the stick, will I be able to build a grand staff with the twigs? But then I'm reminded I'm a beloved son of a God who's got dominion over the sun. In Romans 8, 28, man, I stand on it. This is gonna be my banner, put a flag on it. Hey!
You surround me, Lord, with your graceful care. So open my eyes to your sovereign plans. I surrender my life into your hands.
Summer and winter, springtime and harvest.
sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Join with whole nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. For sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. All strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Oh, great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness.